إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا، يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله عز وجل، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. All praise is due to Allah. We praise Him. We seek His aid and we ask for His forgiveness. We seek refuge in Allah from the evils of ourselves and the evil consequences of our own actions. Whomsoever Allah guides, none can lead astray. And whomsoever Allah leaves to go astray, none can guide. I bear witness that none has the right to be worshipped but Allah alone. None has the right to our ultimate love and devotion but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, who has no partners. And I bear witness that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam is his servant and his messenger. O you who believe, fear Allah as he should be feared, and die not except as Muslims. O mankind, be dutiful to your Lord, who created you from a single person, and from him he created his wife, and from them both he created many men and women, and fear Allah through whom you demand your mutual rights, and observe the rights of your kins. Surely Allah is ever and all watcher over you. O you who believe, keep your duty to Allah, fear him, and speak the truth. He will direct you to righteous deeds and will forgive you your sins, and whoever obeys Allah and his messenger has indeed attained a great achievement. The best speech is the speech of Allah, and the best guidance is the guidance of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. And the worst thing in the religion are the newly invented matters, and all the newly invented matters in religion in Islam are considered to be innovation, bid'ah, and every bid'ah is misguidance, and every misguidance is in the hellfire. In the midst of a lot of the things that are going on around us, in the light of the focus and the light being shed on highlighting Muslim minorities in different places, and the reality of Islam and the reality of Muslims, and in the midst of what we hear is going on against Muslims in different parts of the world, sometimes compromising on their rights, sometimes putting these whole Muslim communities at jeopardy because of some political gains and some agenda. Sometimes the Muslim really feels a little bit threatened, sometimes helpless. What can I do? What should I do? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala advises the Muslims, the early Muslims who were in a similar situation. Allah gives them an advice. And he says, وَدَّ كَثِيرٌ مِّنْ أَهْلِ الْكِتَابِ لَوْ يَرُدُّونَكُمْ مِنْ بَعْدِ إِيمَانِكُمْ كُفَّارًا حَسَدًا مِّنْ عِنْدِ أَنفُسِهِمْ. The people of the scripture, of the book, they wish to make you turn back to disbelief after you embraced faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and you became believers. Out of their jealousy, a sense of envy in their hearts. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, other verses in the Quran, he says and he indicates that the Muslims will face enmity. وَلَتَسْمَعُنَّ مِنَ الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْكِتَابَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ وَمِنَ الَّذِينَ أَشْرَكُوا أَذًا كَثِيرًا. And you shall hear from the people of the scripture and from people of disbelief, you shall hear a lot of bad words, a lot of harm, verbal harm, a lot of threats, a lot of you know, attacks on your rights. Sometimes they might even exceed that limit and reach the point of physical harm and real attacks. Yet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, at the end of all of these verses, He said to the Muslims, وَاسْتَعِينُوا بِالصَّبْرِ وَالصَّلَةِ. And He says, وَأَقِيمُوا الصَّلَاةَ وَآتُوا الزَّكَةَ. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala advises the Muslims that at times of danger, at times of hardship, at times of severe threats against you, you should not lose sight of the importance of the prayer. Because the prayer connects you to Allah, the source of your strength. And if in your understanding the prayer is merely a physical act, you won't be able to understand this verse. And you might even go to the point where you question Allah's wisdom. Somebody might even verbalize it and say, these verses are even impractical. We are being attacked. We are being demonized. We are being compromised. And all of this going around, and all what we do is focus on the prayer. That's because you see it merely as a physical act. But we said, salah and the prayer is such a powerful, profound human experience. And it is meant to strengthen you. And it is meant to connect you to the source of your power, and that's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So I was contemplating what to talk about today. Because there are so many hot topics to talk about, a lot of catchy topics. We can talk politics all day long. But the point is, what's the benefit you will walk away with based on what we talk and what we say here? We can, you know, take all the Muslim sentiment of being victims, of being targeted, and so on and so forth. But that doesn't help us. And that doesn't strengthen us. And that doesn't even increase our iman. And that doesn't even help our situation. There are social activists. There are Muslim leaders among the community. There are people who do a great deal of work, and they deserve our support. They deserve our backing. We should be aware. We should not be disconnected from reality. We should live in our times, being relevant, being responsible, addressing the needs, addressing the challenging circumstances, yes. But not everyone should be a politician. We shouldn't be talking politics all the time or legal issues all the time. In the midst of all of these distractions and all of these topics that can draw us forcefully into them, we should not forget the central point in our life, and that's connection to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and belief in Him. And the reason a lot of the Muslims don't really or lose that focus is that they don't see the power in Iman. They don't see the dynamism in that beautiful concept of Al-Iman, that it empowers you and it puts you in a very positive state to handle your situations. It doesn't call on you to run away from reality and hide from it. That's not what Iman calls us to. Islam or an Iman helps us rise up to the challenge. So I thought of sharing with you something that might seem to be irrelevant, but yet it is actually relevant and very powerful. But it shows us some aspects of our Iman. Because sometimes you speak to a Muslim, they do something wrong, you tell them, they tell you Iman is in the heart. It's in the chest. Yet the Prophet ﷺ, when he talks about Iman, he says in the authentic hadith, Al-Iman bid'un wa sab'una shu'ba. Iman is 70 and something branches. So Iman is not only one small single thing. It's not just a thought. It's not just a state of mind or a state of heart that some people experience at a very tacit level and they don't even realize what it is. But the Prophet ﷺ says Iman is 70 something branches. A'laha shahadatu an la ilaha illallah. The highest of it, the highest of these branches, the most important, the heaviest and the weightiest is to testify that none has the right to be worshipped. None has the right to our ultimate love and devotion except Allah alone. And that Muhammad ﷺ is His messenger. That's the highest and the most important and the most central in Iman, aspect of Iman. Then the Prophet ﷺ says, وَأَدْنَاهَا, and one of the lowest branches of Iman, and that doesn't undermine its value. It just shows a level of priority, a level of importance and weight. وَأَدْنَاهَا إِمَاطَةُ الْأَذَى عَنِ الطَّرِيقِ, and among the lowest of them or probably the lightest of them, that would be a better translation, is to remove the harm from people's way. So you have some dirt, some garbage, something harmful on the sidewalk, on the street. You remove it, or on the stairs, you remove it because you don't want someone else to be hurt by it. You don't want someone else to feel uncomfortable because of that. So you remove it, that's part of Iman. It's part and parcel of Iman. It's a branch of Iman, among the lightest branches of Iman. Then the Prophet ﷺ says, وَالْحَيَاءُ شُعْبَةٌ مِّنَ الْإِيمَانِ. And al-haya, bashfulness, shyness, is a branch of Iman. So the Prophet ﷺ in this hadith clarifies that Iman is not just an elusive concept, an abstract experience. Iman is a holistic experience. It's about who you are. It's about what you believe, who you become as a person, how you behave in different situations. That's what Iman is. So this is why it is dynamic. So when you have Iman and your community is facing a certain challenging situation, it is your responsibility, and that's what Iman calls you to and pushes you to, is to do something for the welfare of the collective group. That's what Islam teaches us. It doesn't teach you to hide. It's not about you just reciting Quran and praying your salat, which are great and good, and then saying, well, everything will fix itself. That's not the way things happen. That's not the way things happen. You know, the historians of in the last 200 years of the history of the Muslim Ummah, in some of the countries, the Muslim lands in Asia Minor, some of those countries that were taken over by the Soviet Union at some stage, the scholars said that in one of the main cities there, when the Soviets were approaching that city to take it over, the Muslims were puzzled what to do. What should we do? Some of them said, let's take up arms and defend ourselves, defend our honor and die. Die with honor instead of living with humiliation. But the majority of them, they said, no. What we will do, we will sit in the masjid and we will start reciting and reading together collectively Sahih al-Bukhari. And the blessings of that is going to help us. Some of you, you know, look at that with amazement. What kind of logic is this? Well, that was prevalent there at the time. That was prevalent. So they thought there would be so many blessings and barakah, which there are blessings and barakah, in reciting Quran or reciting the words of the Prophet ﷺ, but that's not the right way to approach it. That's not the right situation to take the barakah. Because Allah made us live this life and experience it according to the rules that run this life. So you need to assess the situation from so many perspectives. A military perspective. What are the consequences going to be? What are the best options? What are the options we have? We choose the best among them. But for you to go and sit in the masjid and just recite Sahih al-Bukhari, that's obviously not what Islam calls us to. That's a faulty understanding of Islam. So faith is a very powerful. So some people have this kind of wrong understanding. They sort of reduce Iman to some of its small, tiny actions. But that's not the whole thing of it. So your salah, your reciting of the Quran should make you relevant to your times. And if it doesn't, there's something wrong you're doing. There's something wrong in your approach to the Quran and to Islam and to Iman and to Allah. So you need to check it out and you need to fix it. So I'm going to deal with two of the manifestations or aspects of Iman that the Prophet ﷺ pointed to. And these are actually important human traits. Very powerful and very empowering. Very empowering. They will raise the quality of your life. And they will strengthen any community wherever that community is. Although they seem to be very friendly and they seem to be very soft, sort of soft skills. But they are very powerful. Because the human dynamics of power, by the way, are not so straightforward. This is why people sometimes, those who manipulate and have mastered the game of manipulation, sometimes they are too nice, and they are too soft and too compromising. Why? Because that gives them power in the situation. So human dynamics is not about you having the loudest voice. It's not about you stating always your needs and your rights. and having no compromise, life is much more dynamic than this. So in one hadith, the Prophet ﷺ says, "Al-mu'minu ya'laf wa yu'laf." Another narration, another wording of the hadith, "Al-mu'minu ma'lafa, ya'lafu wa yu'laf." وَلَا خَيْرَ فِي مَنْ لَا يَأْلَفُ وَلَا يُؤْلَفُ وَخَيْرُ النَّاسِ أَنْفَعُهُمْ لِلنَّاسِ. Simple hadith, beautiful, profound and powerful. The Prophet ﷺ says, المؤمن, the believer, يألف ويؤلف. What does that mean? That means the believer is easy to get on with. As simple as that. But that's very profound. The believer is someone, it is easy for you to get on with him. He's accommodating. He's kind. He's loving. He's forgiving. He's soft. He gives you space. Yet he's grounded in his turf. He's powerful. He's profound. And he's stable. That's what ya'laf wa yu'laf. So a believer, it's easy for you to get on with a believer, to connect with him. At a personal level, it's easy. And it's easy for him as well to respond with the same. So it's a mutual process. Where does this come from? It comes from a very peaceful heart. The heart has no anger in it. Has no resentment in it. It has no fear in it. So the guy is comfortable. So it's easy for you to handle that man. It's easy for you to deal with him. And if you are troubled, he has the safety, the security, and the space to accommodate you and help you out. That's what a believer is. So, al-mu'minu ya'lafu wa yu'laf, wa la khayra fi man la ya'lafu wa la yu'laf. And there is no good in a person that's not easy to get on with. That's what the Prophet ﷺ says. That's in Sahih Muslim. So we might look at that as a simple trait. It's not a big deal. It is a powerful deal. That means the believer, once you see him, and that's why in another narration the Prophet ﷺ says about the believer is that it's a person that when you see them, you feel you know them. You feel you know them. You know, one day one of the companions, I believe it was Abdullah ibn Abbas, he saw a man he's seen for the first time. He says, "This man loves me." So his students, they said, "How did you know? You haven't seen him. That's the first time you see him." He said, "I know because as soon as I saw him, I loved him. I loved him. And I know he loves me." So he recognized Iman in the heart of that person. He recognized the Iman in that person. So a believer is easygoing, is accommodating. And that reflects balance. It's not weakness. Some people see this as a weakness. It's a source of power. It's a sign of balance. It's a sign of strength. And then the Prophet ﷺ says, and the best among people, خَيْرُ النَّاسِ أَنْفَعُهُمْ. The best among people is the one that is most helpful, that is of most service to others. These are the criteria of Islam. So the Prophet ﷺ linked that trait, personal trait of easygoingness, that a person is easy for you to get on with them and connect with them. The Prophet ﷺ linked it to Iman. Al-mu'minu ya'laf wa yu'laf. So in the Arabic language, this kind of statement shows causality. So Iman leads the person to be easy for you to relate to, easy for you to get on with. And that's why another hadith reported by Imam Ahmad in his Musnad, the Prophet ﷺ says, لِلْمُنَافِقِينَ عَلَامَاتِ. Some, أو كما قال رسول الله ﷺ, the hypocrites have signs. مُسْتَكْبِرُونَ لَا يَأْلَفُونَ وَلَا يُؤْلَفُونَ. They are haughty and full of pride, and it's not easy for anyone to get on with them. These are the hypocrites, the munafiqeen. So that shows that this kind of easygoingness comes from Iman and from faith. That's a beautiful trait. And when we have this, I'll tell you, we will have less disunity among us as Muslims. Less disputes. How often we dispute and we have fights and quarrels over very simple things, tiny things that don't deserve that kind of attention. But we have issues. We don't give each other the benefit of the doubt. We're searching for other people's mistakes. We're searching for an opportunity. We are on the lookout for an opportunity to put someone else down. That shows a troubled heart. That shows a weak heart, and that shows a low level of iman. So that means when a person has a higher level of iman, this person is more easygoing, it's easy to relate to. A second trait, the Prophet ﷺ says, "Al-haya'u wal-imanu qarinan." Or "Al-haya'u wal-imanu qurina jami'a." The Prophet ﷺ says, "Al-haya', bashfulness, shyness, and iman and faith are bound together." Are bound together. They are intertwined. فَإِذَا رُفِعَ أَحَدُهُمَا رُفِعَ الْآخَرُ. So if one of those two things is taken up, lifted, taken away from that person, the other one will follow. What's that strong connection between iman and haya, bashfulness, shyness? And here we're talking about a good form, a good type of shyness. Because people often confuse shyness with timidness. Inshallah, we'll talk about the difference in the second part of the khutbah. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, wa salatu wa salamu ala Sayyidina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. So shyness is one of the branches of iman, and it is connected strongly to iman. So if the person loses their iman, their haya, their shyness, the bashfulness, their sense of chastity will be taken away. And if the person's sense of chastity and shyness and bashfulness is removed, then his iman will also leave him. His iman will also leave him. That's a very important point. One day the Prophet ﷺ saw a man, رأى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم رجلا ينصح أخاه في الحياء أو يلوم أخاه في الحياء. The Prophet ﷺ saw a man blaming his brother for being too shy. So the Prophet ﷺ says to him, دعه, leave him. فَإِنَّ الْحَيَاءَ لَا يَأْتِي إِلَّا بِخَيْرٍ. Shyness and bashfulness can only bring goodness. But shyness is not timidness. Shyness is a sense of chastity, is a sense of respect, is a sense of decency. A sense of decency that you feel shy and you feel bad about yourself should you violate someone else's rights. Or should you do something that is unethical? That's what shyness is and bashfulness is. That's what haya is. So you feel shy, should you cross the limits of Allah? You're going against Him. You feel shy, should you take the right of someone else or violate it? Regardless of what culture you come from or what background you've been brought up in, that's irrelevant. So you feel shy, but that doesn't mean you feel shy and compromise on your rights. That's not shyness, that's timidness. That's timidness. Some people think shyness is to speak, shyness is to speak low, in a low voice, and to be timid, and to hide from reality, to hide from people, keep away from people, and not to stand up for your rights. That's not shyness. That's not haya. The Prophet ﷺ was the strongest among men. Yet, he was described by the companion, كان أشد حياء من العذراء في خدرها. The Prophet ﷺ was more shy and more bashful than a young woman in the deep recesses of her own house. The Prophet ﷺ was shy. But still, when he spoke, people could hear him. When he made a command, it was decisive. When he made a decision, it was carefully taken and was communicated properly. When the rights of Allah were violated, he would stand up for them. When people were violated, he would not stand or take any injustice and be silent about it. So shyness is a very powerful and beautiful personal trait that comes with iman. You cannot fake it. You cannot manufacture it. But the way to get it is to have more iman. And the way to have more iman is to connect to Allah more, recite more Quran mindfully, pray more in a state of khushu', start doing acts of righteousness like kindness to others, like forgiveness, like charity for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not for any personal gain, not for any show off. These two traits are so powerful and they are connected to iman. But the point here is to show that iman is a very dynamic state. is a very empowering human state. It's not a joke. It's not something that we just theorize and talk about. It's not an abstract thing. It's what human life is about. It's about what human life is meant to be, is to be in faith, to believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is how Iman is very powerful. This is why it enables us to handle our situations, to face them, rise up to whatever challenges we are facing. And that we should not back off, and we should not be timid, because that's not shyness, and that's not Iman. And what helps us to do this is to know that life and death is with Allah. And everything that's going to happen, we know it's the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we should accept it when it happens, and we should see how best we can utilize it in the light of the rules of practicality. We're just human beings having a human experience, and we should be relevant to this world and never run away from it. But we should not forget that everything comes from Allah. And if we want support, we need to connect to Allah. We want help, we need to connect to Allah. We want provision, we need to ask it of Allah, even though we engage with the means. اللهم اغفر للمؤمنين والمؤمنات والمسلمين والمسلمات الأحياء منهم والأموات اللهم كن للمستضعفين من المؤمنين في كل مكان اللهم اغفر لهم ذنوبهم اللهم فرج عنهم اللهم فرج عنهم برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين اللهم اغفر لنا ولوالدينا ولمن لهم حق علينا اللهم اهدي شباب المسلمين اللهم اهدي شباب المسلمين اللهم اشف مرضاهم اللهم اشف مرضاهم اللهم اشف مرضاهم اللهم ارحم موتاهم برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين اللهم أبرم لهذه الأمة أمر رشد يعز فيه أهل طاعتك ويذل فيه أهل معصيتك سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين